We welcome you all to this worship service. Let's praise God for his abundance of mercies and love in the past week and days. Let's sing and praise him with familiar choruses. Let's sing, "I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart."
Gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will sing this day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with prayer. I will say, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
The next song we are going to sing is, "He is exalted, a king is exalted over high."
Exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign.
God works in his way, in a mysterious ways, to our prayers. Sometimes we tempt to fear over things which shakes our faith. But remember, because he lives, we face our tomorrows. Let's sing. God sent his son, they call him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive.
Thank you. is worth the living just because He lives.
How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy He gives. But greater still,
as a prayer chorus, let's all sing, sweep over my soul, sweep over my soul, sweet spirit, sweep over my soul. Pray. Dear God, thank you for giving us eternal opportunity, praise and worship, Lord. Lord, we are in your presence. Lord, we are giving ourselves in your hand, Lord. Sweep over us and make us and mold us and use us as an instrument to expand your kingdom in the earth, Lord. Give us the courage to bring out you into the world, Lord. Be with us and help us and guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As we continue to worship the Lord this morning, let's sing this hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. It's hymn number 93 in our hymn.
Come Thou Fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing Thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon, Mount of Thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by Thy help I come. And I hope by Thy good pleasure, safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger, interposed His precious blood. Oh, to grace our greater debtor, daily I am strained to be. Let Thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to Thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for Thy courts above.
The responsive reading for our worship this morning is found in the book of Psalms and the Psalm 81. Let us read responsively from Psalm 81. Sing for joy to God our strength. Shout aloud to the God of Jacob.
Raise a song and strike the timbre and the pleasant harp with the lute.
Sound the ram horn at the new moon, and when the moon is full on the day of our feast.
For this is the statue of Israel, and the law of the God of Jacob.
He established it as a statute for Joseph when he went out against Egypt, where we heard a language we did not understand.
I removed his shoulder from the burden, his hands were freed from the baskets.
In your distress you called and I rescued you. I answered you out of a thundercloud. I tested you at the waters of Meribah.
Hear, O my people, and I will admonish you. O Israel, if you will listen to me.
You shall have no foreign god among you. You shall not bow down to an alien god.
I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt. Open your mouth wide, and I will fill it.
But my people would not listen to me. Israel would not submit to me.
So I gave them over to their own stubborn heart to follow, to walk in their own counsels.
If my people would listen to me, if Israel would follow my ways,
I would soon subdue their enemies and turn my hand against their adversaries.
Those who hate the Lord would cringe before Him, and their punishment would last forever. Let us all read together.
But you would
be fed them the finest of wheat, with honey from the rock, I would satisfy you.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as
The psalmist says in Psalm 81, if my people would listen to me, if Israel would follow my ways, how I will subdue their enemies and satisfy them with good things. The Lord is able to give us victory, and we praise God this morning for the victory as we worship God freely, both online and also meeting together in the church. So we give thanks to God, but we continue to ask Him, Lord, change us, change our hearts. With that prayer, let's go into this time of prayer.
Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like You. You are the
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we bow down in Your holy presence this morning and we acknowledge that You are here with us as we gather in Your name. O God, You are able to look deep into our hearts, and Lord, You know everything, You understand. This morning too, Lord, we pray that You will change our hearts, change our thinking, our perspective, especially Lord, in this time of this great deliverance, as we can also worship You coming to the church. And Lord, as we continue also to worship You online, Lord, we pray for those who are not able to come to church. And we also pray, O God, especially for our children not being able to come into the church and sing songs and worship the Lord. Lord, in Your mercy, we pray that soon You will change all this, so that all this will bring glory to Your name. Lord, we pray for our church. Lord, You are the Lord of the church. You love Your church. You care for Your church. This morning too, Lord, we pray for each and every brother and sister. Lord, we pray for every family, our children, young people, elderly. We commit them all into Your precious hands, O God. O God, in Your mercy, reach out to touch them, to strengthen them, and Lord, to bless them, O God. We also pray for our government. We pray for God's wisdom upon them. Especially pray for the medical fraternity as they go in risking their lives, Lord, to serve and bring about healing and restoration. We pray for Your protection upon them and Your blessing upon them. Especially pray for the police department, pray for volunteers, sanitary workers, asking for Your protection. We also pray for the community around us, asking for Your blessing upon them as well. Lord, we especially remember our children who are doing their studies online. We pray that somehow soon they will be able to go to school and colleges and, Lord, continue their studies. Lord, we especially pray for those in different kinds of needs, asking, O God, that You'll answer their prayers. We pray for those who are awaiting marriage and career. We pray for them, for your guidance in their lives. We pray for those who are waiting, Lord, the blessing of children in their lives. And we also pray those who are in the family way for God's blessing upon them and care during this time. At this time, we really pray, O God, for our leaders, asking for God's wisdom upon them. We also pray for the Methodist Church in India. We pray for Episcopal leaders. Pray for district superintendents, pastors, evangelists, deaconesses. Commit them all into your precious hands. We also remember, O God, all these, Lord, who need your hand of healing upon them. We remember Mrs. Jessie Ratnam. Pray for Yogeshwari and others, Lord, in different physical situations, asking, Lord, for your deliverance in their lives. Lord, we thank you for the team. Lord, this is not the end. We thank you that you're using us and you continue to use us, Lord. Lord, even as we wait in your presence, as your servant brings the word, we pray that you'll speak to us, Lord, and bless our hearts. We thank you, we praise you, we give you all the glory. At this time, we especially remember the teachers and professors. Lord, as we celebrate Teachers' Day, Lord, we ask that you'll bless them, especially as they are preparing and doing a lot of hard work, even through online teaching. I pray, O Father, that you will bless their efforts and make them a blessing. We ask this prayer with thanksgiving and praise in the blessed name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray when we pray, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pause for a moment to pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we bow down in your presence, and we thank you for this time of meditation. Lord, we thank you for our teachers, professors. Thank you for the impact they have on the students and the way that they are a blessing to us. And even as we open the word, O God, continue to speak to us and bless our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today we celebrate teachers, all kinds of teachers. Maybe music teachers, teachers who teach in schools, professors in college, and maybe ad hoc teachers who are helping in different ways, volunteers. But anyway, whatever happens, they have some kind of an impact, influence on people. And also pastor teachers like us, we always pray that the words that we speak, that the Spirit of God would use it to touch lives and to change lives. And that is our prayer. With that, we continue on this ministry. And so, as we celebrate the teaching profession this morning, we look at the life of Paul. Last year, I shared on Teachers' Day about how Jesus is our model. He is indeed. Today we look at the life of Paul and we try to understand how he has been an influence on his congregation, not only his congregation, on others who are his close aides, and how, as pastor teachers and teachers, we can influence those who listen to us. There is a program on the television, not that I regularly follow these programs, but I came across this program called, it's in Tamil, it's called Niya Nana. And there is a debate sharing and debate going on different topics, and one such gathering was on especially about those who scored high marks coming from a very, very low and humble situation. On one side they had the students, and the other side they had their parents. And the anchor, a person who would ask each person, how much did you score in the older system, most of them had scored more than 1,000 marks out of 1,200 in their plus two exams. And he was asking the students on one side and the parents on the other side, what was the motivation behind all this? And the students, many of them said that we scored very well in certain subjects because our teachers, sometimes it could be a man or a woman, they would take special interest in giving them this knowledge on the subject. And we also came across some testimonies about how some of these teachers would invite them home and give them free tuitions. And even knowing that some of these government school students were very poor, some of the teachers even went to the extent of providing milk and solid food for them every day. Not everybody was doing it, but there were teachers who were doing that. And they said it's because of that that we had scored such high marks in our higher secondary exams. So there are people in this world still, probably we do not know their names, it doesn't appear on the papers or the television, but they do influence their students. And that's what we are talking about today. And I, in my own life, I can say that about my own teachers. I remember my daughter, when she finished 10th standard, we had put her in a government-aided school because she wanted pure science. Shemu, the older one. And I remember one day I went to the class teacher and I told her, my daughter is sick. Please let her go. And she told me, Pastor, today I'm taking a very, very important class today. This is the foundational class. If she doesn't understand this, she will not understand anything. If she wants a tablet, I will buy and give her. If she wants a cup of coffee, I will get that for her too. That was the level of commitment of that particular teacher in that school. And we know at different levels, and both in college and school, there are teachers who have that kind of an impact and that kind of a deep commitment to the profession of teaching. They don't see students as mere numbers, but they take special interest in their lives. I know in the seminary there were influential teachers in my school as well, but I very clearly remember this professor in the seminary who taught me Hebrew, and who inspired me to take a special interest in the Old Testament books, particularly the minor prophets. And I'm still grateful to that teacher who took that special effort. We were only three or four in our class because many hesitated to take a new language and do it. But this teacher influenced my life, one Reverend Victor Moses. And so today we are looking at teachers who can influence. We're looking at the life of Paul, and we learn three things from his life. First, we look at 1 Thessalonians and chapter 1 and verses 6 to 12, chapter 2, verses 6 to 12, where he talks about the Thessalonians, and he says, look at what he says in this second chapter and verse 6. We were not looking for praise from men, not from you or anyone else. As apostles of Christ, we could have been a burden to you. But we were gentle among you, like a mother caring for her little children. Look at what Paul says. The first thing that we look at, we see in the life of Paul is his love for the congregation. He says, we were gentle with you, we were not harsh, and we were like a mother to you in your spiritual life. Later on in the same passage, Paul is also saying in the 11th verse, for you know that we dealt with each of you as a father deals with his own children. So here again, this figures of mother and father. And this particular TV program, there were children who did not have parents. Sometimes they grew up with their grandparents. And they were able to shine because some teacher took special interest in those children. And so also here, Paul was saying, we dealt with you, each of you. Sometimes it takes personal attention and care in order to meet the need of that person. And Paul would say that when he came to you as a team and we were ministering in the name of God, we did like that. Why? What is the reason? Look at why he's saying that. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 12. What did we do like a father and a mother, encouraging, comforting, urging you to live lives worthy of God who calls you into his kingdom and glory? We encouraged you, we comforted you, and we urged you. So all these things matter. When there is encouragement either from the pastor or the teacher or from the professor, we know we are really motivated to achieve. And that is the kind of really motivated to follow Jesus, motivated to do well in our subjects. And Paul would say, we encouraged you, we comforted you. There were times you felt like giving up probably, and we said, we comforted you, and we said, don't give up yet, because you have a long way to go. And that is the influence of Paul, and I believe that's how we should be as influencers in this world. Secondly, Paul also talks about his own life in terms of his labor, suffering, and struggle. Look at Colossians chapter 1, or from Colossians chapter 1, verse 24 to 28. He's talking about how he struggled there for the sake of Jesus, for the sake of ministry. Verse 24, this is what he says. Now I rejoice in what was suffered for you, and I fill up in my flesh what will be lacking, what is still lacking in regard to Christ's affliction, for the sake of his body, which is the church. For the church, I was willing to suffer, because I was sharing in the afflictions of Christ. Verse 25, I have become its servant by the commission God gave me to present to you the word of God in its fullness. I do this because God has commissioned me. He has appointed me as a servant. I'm just a servant of God, but God gave me this commission so that I can present the word of God. We are all, as pastors and those who preach, are stewards of the word of God, and we have to present the fullness of the word of God. I do not mean the full gospel as such, but the fullness in its context, not picking up verses from here and there. And we need to be cautious about that, as I told you last Sunday. And so Paul was saying, I have been given this commission, that's what we do. And verse 28, he says, we proclaim him, Christ, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone perfect in Christ. This is the motivation. What motivates me to do this, admonishing and preaching and teaching, so that someday all this will build you up so that you can we can be able to say, we can present you perfect in Christ when, he goes on to say, to this end, I labor, struggling with all his energy, which so powerfully works in me. The word struggling here comes from the Greek word for birth pangs. You know, we struggle so much. It's a painful process. We want Christ to be formed in you, to be perfect in Christ. And we keep on struggling and we do that. And that's how much Paul says, I'm committed to the cause. And teachers too, of course, the aim will be for the exams, so that by the end of the year, or end of the semester, or the class year, they are able to be able to be to show that these students are ready for their exams. And that's the kind of effort they put in, especially in the rural areas and other places as well. Teachers and professors, they take special interest in weaker students, and they do it. I know a particular school, they never give study holidays, because these poor children, they don't have a home in which they can have a special place to silently do their studies. They don't have the physical need, they don't have the physical accommodation in such a way that they could have take time and do their studies. So these teachers know, till the end of the exams, they make them do all their studies in the classroom, and supervising them and helping them and solving all their doubts. And that's the level of commitment teachers have in order to influence many. And that's why in recent times, many students from government schools and colleges are doing well. You know, to give a good example for this kind of an attention, it's about in the sports, how these coaches, they give individual attention to train an athlete in whatever sport that is, if it's running, or if it's high jump, or is it whatever sport, the coach, you have to come to for practice every morning, maybe 5:30, 6 in the morning. And then there is coaching. He keeps on improving your level. You know, by having the stopwatch, you level train again and again and again. Of course, sometimes there are parents who will encourage this. But many a time, parents do not encourage this kind of commitment for sports activity. But we do know that as we are trained, we can excel. And Paul was saying, that's the kind of work we do so that we can someday present you perfect in Jesus Christ. Thirdly, Paul was also a team player. And he encouraged leaders. And we see this, we know that the Colossian church was not his baby. It was the effort of Epaphras. And so when he's talking about Epaphras, look at the first chapter and verse 7 and 8. This is what Paul says in verse 7 and 8. You learnt it from Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is a faithful minister of Christ on our behalf, and who also told us of your love in the Spirit. Epaphras was a person who was instrumental in the birthing of the church in Colossae. Then Paul has this to say, that he is a fellow servant and a faithful minister. Later on in the fourth chapter, he also says about Epaphras, verses 12 and 13, where he says, Epaphras, who is one of you and a servant of Christ Jesus, sends greetings. Then he goes on to say, he is always wrestling in prayer for you, that you may stand firm in all the will of God, mature and fully assured. Here was this young leader, Epaphras, who was instrumental in preaching the gospel in the city of Colossae, and also praying fervently for their faith life so that they would stand firm in the will of God and they would become mature. And this person was doing this work, and Paul appreciates and commends him and says, here is a person who really wrestles in prayer for you. It's not as if, it's not only standing there before the classroom or the church, in the church audience. It's more about how we also pray for our audience as we learn to address them. That is very important. And Epaphras was such a person. Little earlier on, the book of Philippians, we looked that Paul also appreciates these young leaders of Timothy and Epaphroditus. In second chapter of the book of Philippians, Paul talks about Timothy, and he said, I'm sending you Timothy, and in verse 20 of the second chapter, this is what he says, I have no one else like him, like Timothy, who takes a genuine interest in your welfare. For everyone looks out for his own interest, not those of Jesus Christ. But you know that Timothy has proved himself, because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. Here was a genuine person, and Paul takes time to build his team and appreciates the role that Timothy plays in his alongside his ministry. Also, he also appreciates another person, Epaphroditus, in the same passage, chapter 2 of Philippians and verses 25 to 30, where he says, Epaphroditus is my brother, fellow worker, and fellow soldier, who is also your messenger, whom you sent to take care of my needs. The church in Philippi sends Epaphroditus to help Paul in his aged life, and also to especially to take care of his physical needs, as he was very weak in because of his imprisonment. And that's why in verse 30 he says, because he almost died for the work of Christ, risking his life to make up for the help you could not give me. You could send me money, you could send your prayers, but here was a person who humbled himself and came and served me, took care of all my needs, and that kind of help you could not have given me living in Philippi. Here was Epaphroditus coming to me on your behalf and helping me in my need. So we know there are others as well. There was a team around Paul, and he encouraged these leaders to work alongside, and he appreciated their work. And he said, these are people, because when he talks about Timothy, I'm sending you, I have no one else like him who takes genuine, on my behalf, I'm sending him on my behalf. It's as if I'm coming there myself, but Timothy is as good as me coming there because he takes a genuine interest. So he had a team that worked alongside. And we know when we were doing theological studies, there were very, very committed students who came there. Most of them were deeply committed to the ministry. But sadly, many of them could not understand English language. They had a problem with that. And I remember a few students in our class and in many other classes, they would take time to sit with them before the exams and do group study. The only reason they passed in their exams is because some person would take interest in making them sit around. I've done that a few times, not quite so often, but they would sit along with them, and two or three of them, or sometimes more, and they would try to explain the concepts to them in as much as in simple terms, so that they could understand. There was one student, he was a very committed person. When he worked as an evangelist, he brought a whole village, a village consisting of 1,500 people, to Christ. And he was instrumental in doing that in the northeast of India. But when he came to the seminary, he could not understand much of English. But all glory to God, he did very well after 2 or 3 years, and he passed out with flying colors, because there were a few people who were helping him to do group study and understand the concepts, theological concepts, so that they could do well in their exams. Today we are talking about the influence of leaders, teachers, professors, and they have a lifelong influence on our lives. We look back and we are grateful for our teachers, some of them who gave us genuine care, and some of them who inspired us to do something, like my Old Testament teacher. And many of you could testify about the same thing in your life as well. But today, we are celebrating the teaching profession, because even today, many teachers would say, you know, that person who is a collector, he was my student. They would take such pride in saying that. So also, some of them who are genuinely really grateful for their teachers would take time to remember, saying, I did my study in this particular school, in this college, and that really made me into what I am today. Above all these things, Paul was talking about his own ministry, and he was saying, what is our aim? Our aim is so that someday we will be able to present you perfect before God. And when we do that, that will be the greatest achievement in our lives, when God will commend us and say, you've done a good job. And so that is the greatest blessing that we have, as to how much we influence our students, our congregation, or anybody at any level. And people will know it is because of the input of this particular person that something different has happened. And many, we never know how much God might take and use us to touch one life or maybe 10 lives. We never know. When we reach eternity, we will know that God has used us for His glory. May God be glorified. May God continue to bless and use us for His glory. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for, Lord, the very many blessings you have given us, especially the blessing to teach the word, to teach concepts, to teach knowledge and wisdom. And Lord, we thank you that you're using your children, especially those who are deeply committed for this cause, for your glory and to build your kingdom, and also to help many to understand the world and the love of God in their lives. Lord, we thank you for teachers, professors, who have been a blessing. And we pray, Lord, that you'll continue to do so, even as, Lord, we are not able to meet in classrooms, but only online. I pray, O God, that you'll continue to bless and use them for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Dear friends, today is a great day, because even as you're watching online the service, we are also gathering in the church of the living God to worship Him. Hallelujah! What a great day, what a great deliverance God has given. We celebrate and we give thanks to Him for this victory that God has given us in these very trying times. We are grateful to God. Let's continue to pray that more and more people, even those who are at home, may be allowed to come to church, so that we will not have any need to do the recordings anymore. That's our prayer. We also are grateful to God for the blessing of teachers. On the 5th of September, we celebrated Teachers' Day, and we thank you for the We thank God for the blessing of teachers in our community and in the church, professors and teachers in colleges and schools as well. And we bless them in God's name, so that their teaching profession would be such a blessing to our church, to the community, and to our country. So God may God bless them as they continue on. And as we are worshiping in the church as well, as you all know, we continue to have three services in the church. We have one service in English and two services in Tamil. All these details we will be giving you by next week. And we also continue on with the other activities, the Bible study and the prayer times, and the possibly the area-wise prayer as well. So let's continue to rejoice and give thanks to God. Those who are not able to come to the church service and you'd like to send across your offerings, we can make the arrangements for that to be done as well. And those who are doing online, we continue to thank you for your support and your prayers. As we come to this end of this service, in the light of what we've heard, and in closing, let's all sing this hymn, "Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah, Pilgrim through this Barren Land." It's hymn number 271 in our hymnal. For these offerings, let's also pray for those who are celebrating their birthdays and wedding anniversaries. Those who are celebrating their birthdays, Mrs. Ahalya Bakyam, Mr. John Nathaniel, Mr. Ebenezer Ajay, Alan Anand, Andrew Nathan Moses, P. Joshua, Mrs. Tamil Selvi Ponmari Muthu. Anniversaries, Mr. and Mrs. Joseph Nyanakan, Mr. and Mrs. Thomas Marimuthu, Mr. and Mrs. Babu Matthew, Mr. and Mrs. A. Joel, Mr. and Mrs. K. Manogaran. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. You are a God who leads us, God Jehovah, as we pilgrim through this land and our journey of faith. Lord, we thank you for the word that has come to us. And Lord, we also give these offerings and ourselves, asking that you'll accept them and use them for your glory. We especially pray for those who are celebrating their birthdays and wedding anniversaries, asking, O God, that your blessed hand will rest upon them as they step into this new year, and may all your goodness and blessings rest upon them. We thank you, we praise you, we give you all the glory. We ask this prayer with thanksgiving in the blessed name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us all, both now and forevermore.
Bless his holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul,
and forget not all his benefits.
Amen.